how, does this mic work? I don't know how inspirational I am, actually. Yesterday morning I was taking my my daughter to school, and she was complaining that the camera I gave her, which is this wonderful 7D by Canon, wasn't good enough. And when I explained that it was more than adequate for her needs for Facebook and YouTube, she proceeded to tell me that I knew absolutely nothing about photography and nothing about cameras. So maybe she should be here giving this this talk tonight. Thank you, Mikhail. That was a really wonderful introduction, and undeserved, I think. I'd also like to thank you all for coming, Your Royal Highness, everybody. Moreover, I'd like to thank Katie from Canon. Where is Katie, who invited me over here and has been a great supporter of me over the years. Thank you. Thank you, Katie. This is the Ravages of Time photograph. So that's me, believe it or not, with dark hair at the top and down at the bottom a little bit more recently. So those of you who are attending this masterclass and you're in your 20s, that's what it can do to you. So I'm going to start. This is an autobiographical journey, so forgive me. Some of you may have seen some of these things before. I'm just going to put my timer on here so I don't overdo it. So that's me there, bottom left, with my mum, my dad, and my little brother. I grew up in a very, very small town in England, as far away from the ocean as you can get, and as far away from the rest of the world as you can get. And at that time, in that kind of community, you were encouraged very much to not go very far, to stay where you were raised, to work in the area. We weren't really encouraged to have any expectations or any dreams to go very far. But instinctively, I knew that I wanted to go much further. I knew that I needed to leave. In fact, probably the greatest motivation in my life was that desire to leave. And I have a great debt that I've never really acknowledged to Vogue magazine, which my mother bought once a year and used to leave it lying around the house. And I was never interested in becoming a fashion photographer, but Vogue somehow opened up and revealed to me the rest of the world. And I could see that there was a world out there, and it was a world that I was really desperate to discover. I found photography. Like many kids, I had a box brownie and little cameras, but I really found photography through the work of others. I owe another debt of gratitude to a British photographer called Tim Page, who photographed the Vietnam War. And Tim produced a book that I saw as a young man in a bookstore in England. And it wasn't so much Tim's photographs, which were quite familiar, photographs from Vietnam, but it was the narrative of Tim's life that really inspired me. He was a young man who had taken a bus and hitchhiked to Vietnam to cover the war. And when I read that little story about him, I realized that was the means for me to escape the life that seemed to be my destiny. And that photography would be this wonderful way for me both to get out and to also fulfill all the other needs that I had had. You can see up here, I grew up in the time of Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan. The specter of a nuclear war, if you can imagine such a thing, hung over us all the time. We would have nuclear war sort of warnings and exercises at school. So I became very political as a young man, as most young men or many young men do. And I really wanted to take on governments and challenge authority, as my teenage daughter does now. And I realized that photography was a way for somebody of limited means, from a very ordinary background in the middle of England, could do that. And these are some of the things that inspired me at the time. The Vietnam War was raging when I was a child, and the work of three great British photographers, Philip Jones Griffiths, Larry Burrow and Don McCullen was published all over the country, and that really fueled my interest in photojournalism, and through them I discovered other photographers. I'm also in this picture, right in the middle there with a very dear friend of mine, Philip Blenkinsop. So
I needed to go somewhere. I ran into Tim Page one day in London at an exhibition, and I asked him, I said, hey, you know, how do you do it, man? How should I get out there? What's the path? And he said to me, he said, well, you can try and get a job for a newspaper in England and basically wait for someone to die before you're given an opportunity, or you can just go out there and do it. So I decided to go out there and do it. I spent 2 or 3 years working in building sites and restaurants and working as hard as I could. I even swept a castle at one point and saved up enough money, which I think I had. I think I left England with about £700, about $1,000, and flew to Southeast Asia and started working in the Cambodian refugee camps in Thailand. It was a great place to go, Thailand. It was very inexpensive, full of terrific stories that were very, very accessible. And being poor there was easy, and I was very poor. And the title of this talk, I think, is what, selling your own blood but not selling your soul. And one of the ways, I used to run out of money all the time. I used to sell my blood so that I could eat. But the problem was I couldn't give blood often enough to be able to afford to keep myself in food frequently enough. So I lost a lot of weight, a lot skinnier then than I am now. My agent at this time, I found an agent. His name was Simon Goodman. He was a Dadaist. He fled Germany under the Nazis, went to Paris, ended up in London. He was the guy who gave Robert Capa his first camera, a camera that Capa then sold down in the south of France and pawned. And Simon was a Marxist, and when I started working in Southeast Asia, all my publications were in workers' newspapers and the Communist Daily, which may have been how I managed to get access to the Khmer Rouge, as the Khmer Rouge soldiers' feet with mine there. Poverty was my friend, in fact, and poverty and being poor is something that a lot of young photographers are very afraid of. But I found that it worked to my advantage. I could go off for several weeks into Cambodia, as I did with various guerrilla forces, and I could afford to stay there for a very long time. Wealthier photographers, more established photographers, couldn't afford that time. They needed to be on assignment, they had commitments at home. So I learned very early to use what seemed to be weaknesses. They appeared to me, in fact, to be great strengths, and I learned to use them. This is the Khmer Rouge up here. I got hold of a book at this time. It was a book written in the 12th century by a Chinese traveler called Travels in Cambodia, and I used to take this with me on these journeys that would last up to about 6 weeks. And I remember reading this book, and when I looked at Cambodia, it really hadn't changed very much, and I started to photograph Cambodia. As I started to photograph Cambodia, I realized little had changed, and that book that was then about 800-900 years old became a great companion, actually, and a sort of a narrative for me to work my way through the country. One great lesson I learned in Cambodia, and this stayed with me for the rest of my life, as a consequence of immersing myself in somebody else's culture and spending an awful lot of time there, not having the money to stay in a hotel, having to sleep in villages. One of the things I learned is that, it sounds silly now, I know, but not to trust the books that I had read, not to trust the status quo, not to trust the newspapers that I was reading. When I was in Cambodia, I was told many, many times by villagers that life under the Khmer Rouge, for them, was much less worse than it was under any other political regime that they had experienced. And that really shocked me, as you can imagine. The explanation, of course, is that the Khmer Rouge empowered villagers at the expense of urban people. But that information was really golden, it was really very useful, and I understood that there was a conflict between what I thought I knew and what I was hearing on the ground. And to understand any country, it was really necessary to immerse yourself as far as you could in that culture. Get out of the five-star hotel, get out of the car, and talk to ordinary people, not people who walk the corridors of power, but very, very ordinary people. And that was the only way to really understand what was going on and be properly informed. And from that, many, many stories would come. So I spend a lot of time in the rain, as you can tell. So after 4 years in Asia, I migrated to Bosnia. I went, hadn't been home. I hadn't had really any contact with home. These were the days, if you could imagine, when communication was by telex or by letter. There were no mobile phones. And this is when faxes started to arrive. In fact, at this time, I think there was one fax machine and one phone in the whole of Cambodia. So I had not been in contact with my family. And after 4 years or so, I went back to Europe for a wedding. And when I was in Europe, a great friend told me that I should go and visit Bosnia, and which I did. And I didn't return, in fact, to Asia for many, many years. But Asia always stayed with me, and to this day it has remained the most important person in my creative, the most important place in my creative life and in my spiritual life. And it's where I always go back, where I always return to work. And I think those formative experiences, the experiences and relationships you make very early on in your life, can really inform you for decades to come. Now, when I went and started working in Bosnia, I really didn't know what I was doing. And I think I kind of knew that. I pretended that I did know what I was doing, but I really didn't know what I was doing. But the way that I worked in those days was I would be shooting film. Every roll of film that I shot would have a number, put it in a caption envelope, and then ship it off to New York or Paris. I would receive instructions from New York or Paris by telex or sometimes fax or satellite phone in Sarajevo telling me what to do next. I'd listen to the BBC World Service when I was in Bosnia or elsewhere in the world, and from that I would figure out what to do that week. I'd then go off and cover that story, ship my film to New York or Paris at the end of the week. Shipping, in fact, became the major preoccupation in your life. And believe it or not, many of the photographs that I took in that period from 1989 to up to really 2001, I have never seen. They're still in boxes in my studio. It's a very, very, very different world to the one that the young photographers here are experiencing. It had advantages, of course, and disadvantages. One of the advantages, I think, was that you were out of touch and you could immerse yourself in places without constantly being reminded of home. During this period, this was really my photojournalism writ large period. I was working out with my children. I think I visited 95 countries in about 15 years, many of them multiply. It's too many countries. My entire life was driven by assignments. And as we say in England, I started to feel that the tail was wagging the dog. I had really lost control of my career. My career was being driven absolutely by the clients that I was working for. And in many cases, these were clients that I didn't actually have a relationship with. The relationship that I had with clients was run entirely through the photo agency. So it was a very, very sort of disconnected life. And it was a life that I never really sought. I didn't want to be a globe-trotting photojournalist, visiting all of these places and not really knowing them, parachuting in and out. I was much more comfortable being immersed in something. So after covering Bosnia for 6 or 7 years, Kosovo appeared. This was really the end game of the political crisis in Yugoslavia. And when I looked back at the work that I produced in Bosnia, I realized that I had not cut to the chase. I hadn't addressed the single most important issue and the thing that really caused me greatest concern, which was the issue of justice and the issue of war crimes. And I had really been running from one spectacular event to another spectacular event, driven by the need to fulfill assignments and fulfill the obligation that I felt that I had to my photo agency. So when Kosovo came, I thought to myself, I'm going to stop this. And I was inspired very much by Gilles Perez, who I'm sure many of you know, and if you don't know him, you will have heard of him. He's a remarkable photographer with Magnum. And I was very fortunate to have him as a great friend and traveling companion for many years. And Gilles used to always challenge me, and he would say things like, Gary, what do you see over there? I'd say, well, you know, two guys in a field, Gilles. And he'd say, no, think again. I'd say, well, you know, two guys in the field with a cow. And he'd say, no, it's the end of empire. And he, but I, you know, to this day, don't understand what he means, but he was always challenging me to think and to see things very, very differently and never look for the obvious. So when Kosovo came around, I spoke to Gilles, and we traveled together. He came in my car, and I spoke to Gilles, and I said, look, you know, I really want to photograph this differently. I really don't want to go there and just photograph another war, more burning houses, more violence. And he encouraged me to really spend a lot of time thinking about how I was going to photograph this issue, not what I would photograph. That's pretty easy, that's pretty straightforward, but how? What was I trying to say? What did I have to say? What did I have to offer? And how did I think I would do it? So I'm just going to play a little selection of pictures, but the way that I constructed this story is this. I wanted to look at war crimes, and war crimes, of course, principally are committed when you're not looking. I needed to figure out a way to photograph, you know, this injustice. And whilst I was trying to figure that out, I was up in Albania talking to a lot of principally women, Kosovar women who were coming into Albania, telling me stories about their husbands who had been killed, friends who had been raped, and their neighborhoods that had been burned down. And I started gathering this data in my notebooks and photographing them, of course. And then the International Criminal Tribunal for Yugoslavia published an indictment of Milosevic, which a colleague downloaded on a sat phone, printed out in northern Albania, and showed to me. And when I saw this document, I thought, this is the narrative structure for this essay. I should illustrate this indictment. The indictment listed every crime that the Serbs had committed in Kosovo up to a certain point. It listed all the people who had been killed, precisely where. And I thought, I'm going to use this as my roadmap around Kosovo, and I'm going to illustrate this indictment. The indictment came in three parts, or four parts, but two of them deal with one issue. The first part is deportation, the second part is persecution, and the third part and fourth part are murder. So whilst I was reading this, I had in mind publishing a book. This whole project is sort of, it was executed, it was shot with one purpose in mind. I had a very clear layout in mind, a layout for the magazine. This was the first time, again, learning from Gilles, I decided that I wanted to construct a layout for this story. I had in mind the outcome, and when I set off, I did everything with great deliberation. And I decided to approach this story not as a photographer, but in a forensic way, as an investigator. And so I didn't pay much attention to the photography, which was really very liberating, because I've never truthfully been very interested in being a photographer per se. I think photography is a wonderful tool, but it's not something that, for me, is the ultimate objective. So I approach this as a forensic investigator. What I'm going to show you now is just a very short piece set to music, three chapters of this project. A few images from deportation, which is self-evident, a few images that illustrate persecution, which in the context of this document is the destruction of people's livelihoods, places of worship, homes, and then murder again, which is self-evident. Thank you. So this project, it was the first time where I really employed the use of found photography, really used landscape, and where I took control, absolute control over the way I told the story, the way I executed it, the timing of the delivery, absolutely everything, all the outcomes. And it was incredibly liberating because up until this point, really, you know, I'd spent many years doing the bidding of others, which I was finding, you know, increasingly frustrating. And it's also when I discovered, and forgive me if you, any of you have been told otherwise this week, but it's my belief that style for a photographer, apart from clothing, as Max will tell you, but style for a photographer is a death trap. Style, for me, is reductive. And all my career, I've been told, you know, you have to find a style. You've got to find a style. It's the, you know, it's the gold standard. It's the holy grail. But what I realized is that the world's a really rich and varied place, and every story is different. And if I tried to squeeze every story and every country, every continent, every issue into one style, it was one very dogmatic of me, and I was going to miss an awful lot. So I rejected at this point absolutely a personal style. And that, you know, may have harmed my career in some ways, but it actually set me free. And it was, after all, to be free, to be at large, that, you know, drove me in the first place to be a photographer. So I didn't want photography to act as a constraint. And that leads me really to this band of desperados. This is Severn. It was in Kosovo, in fact, in 1999 that you know, I first decided that if I wanted to belong to an agency, given that the agency I was in had just been sold to Corbis, instead of trying to join another agency, I should better off just building one by myself with my friends. And that really has been, you know, the pattern of my career, which is if you don't find things, if you can't find anything that works for you, don't join the best thing, make your own. And I think that's a you know, something that I'd like you all to take home with you. Don't feel that you have to dance to anybody else's tune at all. You know, at Severn, we were very lucky when we launched the agency, and that the world changed in a way that you know, really played to our strengths. But in many ways, you know, we ended up quite frustrated because we were labelled as the kinds of photographers that we never really saw ourselves as. Severn, you know, very quickly got a reputation for being a war photographer's agency, and that was never the way that we saw ourselves. So this sort of act of liberation, if you like, ended up becoming a little bit restrictive in some ways, and we've always fought to try and, you know, throw that shackle off. This story here, this is very, very typical of the kind of work that I was doing for the longest time for Newsweek. Although it didn't set off, I didn't set out to cover this story in this way. War in Iraq obviously was we all knew that it was coming way in advance. And Newsweek were talking to all of its contributors and figuring out, you know, how we might all cover this story. And I decided that for me, this was less a story about Iraq, actually, but more a story about American hegemony. And that was the perspective from which I wanted to photograph it. So I said to Newsweek, you know, can I go to Kuwait, you know, cross the border with the invading troops, and then work in that vacuum, that space behind the American troops where the civilians are, and cover the war that way. I'll shoot film, I'll disappear, and when I'm done, I'll ship it home to you. And they said, yeah, absolutely, that's fine, Gary, no problem. Those were the days, right? But things didn't work out that way. 3 or 4 days before the invasion started, they called and they said, listen, we've changed our minds. We want you to shoot digital, color, so that we can use your work with all the other photographers' work. And no disrespect to my friends at Canon there, but I had never used a digital camera, and I didn't know how to use the step phones, the new software. They sent me all of this equipment by FedEx. It arrived, and I left and went to war, terribly confused, with one battery and one flash card, which meant that I could only shoot, you know, JPEGs. I really didn't know what I was doing. But anyway, I'm not going to tell you the whole story of this war. It will take far too long on my coverage of it. But I ended up, in fact, once I crossed the border, I lived in a date grove with Luke Delahaye and Enrico Danino for a few days. And when we crossed over, it was absolutely chaotic. And I asked the US Marine which way the US forces had gone. He pointed up a road. I went up the road and drove into an Iraqi tank battalion. And, you know, we were both surprised to see each other, and I managed to extract myself. Went down another road and had a very similar experience with some irregular troops. And I realized at that point that I couldn't cover this war in the way that I'd anticipated, and I had to find another solution, which involved driving through the desert for several days until I drove it in a sandstorm into the 3rd Battalion, 4th Marines, who are these guys here. And I stayed with these Marines for about four weeks, really doing very little apart from sitting in my car and slowly progressing towards Baghdad. And what was happening is that the colonel of the regiment was just keeping an eye on me and my colleagues and seeing, you know, whether we were good company or not. And after about 3 weeks, he determined that we were, largely, I think, because I'd given the Marines my satellite phone. They'd been able to call home. I ran up a $45,000 satellite phone bill that Newsweek paid for. And in fact, at one point during one battle, I heard one of the Marines say, "Hey, you know, make sure the English guy's okay. He's the guy with the phone." So that was, you know, my part in that war was really, as far as the Marines were concerned, was providing them with calls home, because they hadn't called home for you know, 6 months, some of them. And they'd had, you know, children in that time, and obviously their families were very, very anxious. During this period, I wasn't embedded, so I was free to leave this unit anytime I wanted, but I had this terrible dilemma. You know, I'd invested all of this time, several weeks, and it was a really, truly, truly dreadful few weeks. As you can imagine, this was a very significant war, and it was very, very stressful. But also, I wasn't seeing anything, and I wasn't getting any pictures that the magazine, who were paying this enormous phone bill, could use. So I was under an awful lot of pressure to deliver, and every day, you know, I'd wake up and think, should I leave this unit or should I stay? You know, what is the smart decision to make? And I decided to stay because they were a hyper-aggressive unit, and usually at the front, and so it was obvious that should we be allowed to cover their activities, that they would certainly be interesting. And if I went off into the desert, I would either get killed, lost, or, you know, find another unit with whom I'd have to build a new relationship. But it was a very, very difficult professional decision at the time. This unit finally allowed us to photograph them. As they reached Baghdad, they had to take a bridge. The bridge was essential so that all the Marines could come up from the south and, you know, liberate Baghdad. The army were on the other side of the Tigris River. So with my one battery, my one flash card, the unit were attacked by the Iraqis, and a battle that lasted for 2 days started. So what I'm going to show you now is just a small number of pictures from that battle. We'll be right back. So this was a really uncomfortable experience for me, as you can imagine. I was used to wars. I covered an awful lot of wars up to this point. But this was a particularly savage one. We were hit by US aircraft. The unit was bombed. We were hit by US artillery. Most of their casualties were friendly fire. It landed right on top of our unit. One shell, as you saw there, went through the turret of one of their vehicles. This unit killed an awful number of civilians. And in the end, you know, the bridge that they took was unsuitable for purpose, and they had to build a new one. And in that context, I was working for a magazine, Newsweek, that I'd worked with for a very long time, who failed to really tell the truth, who failed to deal with the issues in the prelude to the war, and who failed to deal with the issues properly during the war and shortly afterwards. And as did most media organizations in the United States, in fact, until Seymour Hersh wrote the piece about Abu Ghraib in the New Yorker. And so I was getting very, very, very disillusioned working for the press, not with the press, but for the press, because I felt that we were really failing to challenge the status quo. We were reinforcing the status quo constantly, practically every story I did in this sort of hierarchical form of journalism was prescribed. It was pre-written, pre-thought, and what was demanded of you was really evident. You had to make the world look the way that everyone expected it to look. And I became, you know, increasingly frustrated by that. These are just a few pictures here. This is one of the first projects which really started to have another life. I kept in touch with a young lieutenant, Tim McLaughlin, from this unit. And when I went up to Harvard to do the Nieman Fellowship, he lived close by with a friend, Peter Maas. We went to visit him and uncovered his diaries. He made diaries of the war, personal diary and an official Marine diary. And what Peter and I realized, Peter was one of the correspondents who covered that war and was traveling with me, is that Peter had a very, very different version. Peter's experience of that war were quite different to mine, and his recollections of it were quite different to mine, because he was 50 yards away in a different direction, seeing something quite different. What we realized is that Tim's recollection was also very, very different. Tim was in a tank, and he was a Marine. And, you know, this, when we came together and created an exhibition and a project that is still traveling around universities and galleries around the States, we put together this project that reveals the war to be something very different to the narrative that you're all probably familiar with that was published in the media. And I think when you finish the story, it should remain live on your desktop or wherever, and it really never ends. There are many, many ways to revisit old stories, and there are other truths to be told, and there are conversations to be had. And don't be afraid of seeking out collaboration. You know, when I started in this business, you were a lone photographer out there with a few rolls of film shipping envelopes back, and increasingly over time, collaboration has become not only necessary, but really, really interesting. And adds an incredible amount of value to the work that you produced. In 2009, I had already made the decision to move away from journalism, and I was fortunate enough to be given a fellowship at Harvard University, where I was paid to go and think and read and draw and pretty much do what I wanted for a year. And I took great advantage of that. I really learned how to write. I learned how to see differently. I didn't take a photograph for a year. Anything visual was drawn. And I studied with a lot of very interesting professors, particularly a professor called John Stilgo, who I'll talk about in a moment, but with whom I studied the built environment. And when I was working with Professor Stilgo, I learned to look at my surroundings in a very, very different way. And I learned that the landscape has great narrative potential and great storytelling potential. So when I left Harvard, I went down to Arizona to see a friend and helped him launch a book, and he drove me around the desert. And as I was driving around the desert, I saw the architecture and landscape of immigration, but I never saw any immigrants. And I thought, that's pretty interesting. There were traces of them everywhere, fragments of clothing on fences, technologies that had been developed for Iraq and Afghanistan that the law enforcement agencies used. But I never saw any immigrants. And I thought, wow, this is very, very interesting. And I'm sure that I can deal with this issue of immigration just through photographing the landscape. So I started a collaboration with a museum, the Museum of Contemporary Art down in Tucson. I went to see them and asked them if they would be interested in collaborating on the project. I found a local NGO. I applied for grants I started working with two universities, Tufts University and the University of Arizona, to put together a project that looked at immigration through the prism of landscape. And I'm just going to show you now. Hopefully this will work. This project. What you need to know here is that I start in, I start with this picture of a flag, but then I move to the air. I found someone who had a plane who agreed to fly me around for the cost of the fuel. And I realized that I needed that perspective. I needed to get airborne to be able to deal with this landscape. I couldn't photograph everything from the ground. That's America on the right, California, and Mexico on the left. And I was really interested in some of the details. Why does that fence end there? But it ends there because beyond it are mountains in the desert through which, if you pass, you will die. So you don't need to go to the expense of making a fence. So I was flying around for several days, photographing. Here we have America in the south, Mexico in the north, photographing the architecture, any evidence of immigration that I could see from the air. These tires are used to tow behind border patrol trucks, and they cut the trail, clean all of the traces that immigrants leave, so in the morning the border patrol can see where they've been walking and then track them through the desert. And these white vehicles I would see, these tiny white vehicles are border patrol vehicles, and I became rather fixated with portraying them in the desert. It gives a great sense of scale. There is one here you can't see because of the resolution, but it's smack in the middle. So just looking for these tiny, tiny, tiny traces in the landscape of immigration. Chases through the desert, they overturn. The tracks on the bottom are tracks that migrants make through the desert. The track to the north is border patrol tracks. So I flew up with someone from a local NGO who went out with a GPS, and that's why I knew where to go, all the locations. Here you have a housing estate, basically, and that corner of the road there is where a lot of migrants come out. This is a village, half of which is in Mexico and the other half is in the United States. So you can see I'm now on the ground. Well, not here. So if you're a migrant, you get in trouble, you find one of these beacons, you press it, the police will come, arrest you, and then send you back, but you won't die. There's a bunch of illegal migrant workers building a fence for the Americans to keep illegal migrants out. This is all technology that was developed in Iraq and Afghanistan. A lot of it, you have cameras here that can see for 12 miles. And I was constantly being picked up crossing over into Mexico, and I could never figure out how they could see me, and it's this technology. This is a project that is constructed and conceived in a very different way to all the other projects that I think I've ever done, and I've spent most of my life photographing people from pretty close proximity. Here's the details that are interesting. This candle that you see at the bottom there was carried several miles for days in someone's backpack to put at a grave. And so migrants would carry things to leave on the graves of people who passed before them. A lot of women get raped, and they take contraceptive pills often before they make this journey. And then when they get to the places where they get picked up and driven up to Arizona, up to Tucson and Phoenix, they often leave their clothes. And a lot of these scenes reminded me very much actually of the Evidence Project in Kosovo. And these blankets, little squares of blankets, are what you tie on your feet to cover your tracks. So I'm going to fly through this because we've taken up a little bit more time than I anticipated. But all through my career, I've always fought to be free of constraints and just to be at liberty. Really. And once I made the decision that I didn't want to work for the press anymore, I obviously had to figure out what I was going to do and how I was going to structure my career and how that might look. And it took me a little while to figure out, but I was inspired actually by Max Pam, who's sitting down here, who I had the fortune to teach with about 10 years ago. And as you probably know, Max is a professor down at a university in Australia. And when I had the fellowship at Harvard, I was really, really got very, very involved in academic life, and I really enjoyed teaching, and I really enjoyed studying, and I enjoyed all the facilities that a university has to offer. And whilst I was there, I was offered a position at Tufts University, which I didn't really want because I didn't want to be working full time, but I talked to them and established a situation for myself where I'm pretty much free for about 8 months of the year to work by myself on my own projects, but I have a studio at the university and I teach students every spring. And that really set me free from this sort of hierarchical, prescribed storytelling life that I'd had before. And it gave me the possibility to start collaborating with lots and lots of people. And now that's really what I do. My whole career is now built on fundamental collaborations with large numbers of people, most of whom have got nothing to do with photography, but people who are very, very involved in the issues that I'm interested in. They might be anthropologists, ethnographers, cartographers, museum curators, you name it. So this is a little work that I've been doing in Asia over the years. I spent a lot of time in Asia. I'm very, very passionate about Asia. It's where I like to spend most of my time. And it's where I feel most free. I keep extensive journals. I collect lots of ephemera. And the way that I work there these days is I have no agenda. I go to a country, I really have no, do no research, I have no plan, generally speaking. I go and I figure it out when I'm there. And very often I'll go and see a friend and have dinner and ask them, you know, what's going on, what's of interest, and really just follow my nose. And it's a very, very different way of working. And that's really inspired by my earliest forays into Asia where, you know, talking to local people, getting involved in local life, revealed so much of this great continent that, you know, otherwise really would have been hidden. If I found all my stories in The Economist or in, you know, the New York Times or the New Yorker, you know, I'd be doing the same stories that everybody else did, probably in the same way. This picture is one of my favorites. It was photographed in India, and it's one of my favorites because I can't remember what this guy is pulling, and it really doesn't matter. It could have been his wife, could have been a goat. But it's what's outside the photograph. You know, I'm not really particularly interested in what photographs show. That's, I think the photograph is the beginning of a conversation and beginning of an exchange and a dialogue, both by me with the people who I'm photographing and my photographs with the audience. I think the photographs in themselves are much less interesting than what's not in them. This photograph I show because at the beginning of my career, I would have been, you know, photographing this sad-looking man on the right-hand side with a blanket over his head to show poverty in India. And at this stage in my career, I recognize that poverty doesn't mean misery. Poverty is just a material thing. And that, in my experience, you know, most of the people I think who live fulfilled lives, we would refer to as being incredibly poor. And so these two boys, these two young men on the left, holding hands and walking through the streets of Old Delhi were much more interesting to me. And, you know, a friend of mine once referred to sort of the street photography, as you like, if you like, a sort of method photography. And I like to be close enough to people that you can smell them and they can smell me. I like to be very, very, very close to people when I'm working in the streets. And I love that exchange and I love the theater and I love the dance. Now, this picture's in here because I've tried for years to successfully photograph a camel. So, and I think this is the most successful picture of a camel that I have ever made. And it's because I didn't try and get the whole camel in there. And I think if you think too literally, you come unstuck. There aren't many ways you can photograph a giraffe if you want the entire giraffe in your picture, right? So, you know, sometimes you have to think a little laterally. Very interested in history. And I visit a lot of historical places, and this is a quarry that, you know, has been mined for 500 years. So I get very involved in history, and I gravitate towards places that have been used by man for many, many years. This is a Dharavi slum, so-called, in Mumbai. And when I went to Dharavi slum, you know, I was anticipating seeing lots of very poor people, you know, just being poor. But I didn't see many poor people just being poor. What I saw is a hell of a lot of people working really hard. And I started to dig around a little bit, and I understood that this slum generates between $500 and $650 million a year in business activity. And you have million-dollar weaving machines in this place. They're incredibly active and vibrant places, and that's the kind of thing that I'm really interested in exploring now. And issues of identity, this is a Muslim man in Calcutta, this is in Kashmir. You know, you take these giant countries, India or America, do people really identify with being American? Do they identify as being Indian? Often not. They identify as being something else. It might be Jewish, it might be Muslim, it might be Naga. But I'm very, very, very interested in this issue. This is in there because it's just preposterous, really. Gender, obviously a very big issue. These girls here peering through this window are actually looking at the body of their brother who was inside, but they weren't allowed to go inside to mourn him. He had been killed by Indian security forces. So I spend a lot of my time on the streets, just walking around, following people, and, you know, trying to find some magic in very, very ordinary places, and absolutely not seeking out the spectacular, which is what I spent most of my career doing, because I thought that's what you needed to do if you were a photographer. On the left here, you have the most beautiful road I think I've ever driven down, and you can see all these trees that have been stripped. They're sort of pruned, really, at the end of the year. And the serendipity of time is on the right-hand side, you have a very similar-looking scene, but that's Tora Bora in 2001 after it had been hit by a B-52 strike. Spent a lot of time very recently working in Burma with some of you in the room. And it's a country that I've become really, really fixated with and very, very interested in. And particularly interested in ethnic tribes. This is my portrait of Aung San Suu Kyi. Can't imagine sending that to Newsweek. And I've been very, very interested in looking at, you know, the indigenous tribes in Burma and all over Southeast Asia. And this is a village that has been displaced that looks very much like it has electricity, but it has the pylons, but no one can afford, of course, the $500 it takes to have them connected. So what I'm working on now, so just to finish here and show you how, you know, my career has migrated, I'm now working on a project in Burma with ethnographers, anthropologists, archaeologists, cartographers, museums in Burma, museums in the United States and in Europe, and academics in all of those places. And a very, very, you know, broad-scoped project that is trying to document the lives of people who have rejected the rule of lowland societies and have sought refuge and independence in the highlands. And these people number about 140 million people live in these areas in India, China, Burma, Thailand, Laos, Vietnam, and Cambodia. It's an enormous society that we often marginalize as being sort of savage hill tribes, exotic people, but in fact they're very, very sophisticated cultures who have adapted their way of life to being constantly on the move, constantly evolving, and, you know, the real anarchists. So this is the kind of project that I'm very, very interested in working on now, and a very, very, very big shift from the way I used to work earlier in my life. Love pictures like this, very, very simple pictures, coming of age pictures. See a lot of car crashes, slightly strange things, photographing, yeah, just very, very ordinary life. And I'm going to end now with two pictures. These are the two most interesting pictures I think I've taken for a very, very long time. Perhaps the two most interesting pictures I've taken in my life. And here's why. In this village, which is in northeastern India, I was walking around and I could understand what the people were saying, but I couldn't really figure out why I could understand, because I didn't speak the dominant language in the area. And it took me a little while, but I realized that they were speaking a language that sounded like Khmer, and I learned Khmer when I was working in Cambodia, and I still remember enough of it to notice it. And I thought, wow, what are these people doing? This is the last outpost of Khmer. And it was unclear to me whether these people migrated from Cambodia or were in fact the original Khmer who had made it across this border. But that's not why I'm showing you this picture. I'm showing you this picture because that there is a bridge. And it's a bridge that is made out of tree roots, and it's called a living bridge. And it was made by two communities on either side of the river who kept having their bridge washed away. So they got together and figured, how can we make a bridge that lasts, that doesn't get washed away? It was essential, of course, for trade and for young men to meet young women. So they decided to make a bridge out of tree roots, and it took 150 years. And I was traveling with an Indian friend who told me there is no way now, today, that anybody in this village or any other village that he knew of in India would conceive of making a bridge that they didn't get to use. A bridge for people six generations hence. And these are the kinds of things that I'm really, really fascinated in and really, really interested in. They don't make for, you know, spectacular photographs, but I really don't care. It's the narrative, it's the stories behind them that most concern me. And this man, this is my favorite picture. This man I met walking down a road in a village in Burma, and he was carrying a machete and a piece of bamboo. And I asked him what he was doing, and he said, well, I'm preparing a little shelter for my son. He's getting married and there's a wedding party. You can come if you want. And I said, oh, that's very interesting. I asked him a few questions. Where did your son meet his wife? You know, neighboring village. And he went off to get a job there and met this wonderful lady. Fantastic. I said to him, so would you mind telling me what makes a good wife? And he said, yeah, she's got to be strong as an ox so she can work in the fields. She's got to be a really terrific cook. And she's got to be able to look after the household. By the way, you know, there's nothing really surprising there. That was an answer I could have anticipated. So I said, well, would you mind telling me what makes a good husband? And he looked at me and he said, there's no such thing as a good husband. And I'm going to leave it there. Thank you.